are here assembled to pay our last tribute of respect to our departed comrade. When the call of our country was heard, Comrade William Davies answered. Self was forgotten in the cause of the greater good. As a brave man, he marched away, putting the abiding faith in his God, his country, and his flag. The red of our country's flag has been made redder still by his heroism. The white, more stainlessly pure, by the motive which it held. And in the starred field of our nation's glorious banner, the blue had been glorified by the service he has given for his American ideals. Chaplain, please invoke the divine blessing.
Almighty and most merciful God, Father of all, admit these monuments of the dead we see dying. As comrade after comrade departs, we march home with the ranks grown thin. Help us to be faithful and obedient to one another. We beseech thee, look in mercy on all that you have suffered, and with thine own tenderness, the soul comfort over thee by the hand of death. Give them the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of bitterness. Heavenly Father, bless our country with freedom, peace, and righteousness, and through thy sovereign and holy spirit's favor, they will all be that asked for thy throne of grace and help. And unto thy great name shall we praise forever and ever. Amen.
One by one, as the years roll on, we are called upon to fulfill these sad duties of respect to our departed comrade. The present, full of the cares that beset all nations, whether engaged in war or peace, fades away as we look back on the day that this comrade left his home to defend his country. Imbued by a spirit of devotion and inspired by an undying love of his native land, he gladly went forth and joined with comrades both young and old to preserve our heritage of freedom. We trust that the example set by our comrade will prove a glorious beacon to the youth of our country, who may be called to uphold the honor of our flag at any time. As the years roll on, we too shall be laid to rest, and our souls follow the long column of the realms above. As all unfolding death, hour by hour, shall mark his retreats. Comrades and friends, let us so live that when the keeper of eternal records shall have called our name for the last time, those we leave behind will say of us, as we now say of this comrade, here lies all that is mortal of a true-hearted comrade and a fearless defender of his country and his flag. Captain.
The march of our comrade is over. He lieth down at a house appointed for all the living. This grave reminder of the frailty of human life depending on which you hold your own. Such an hour as you think not, the final sum may come, which no one disagrees. It seems fitting that we should leave our comrade of the United States in our service to rest under the arching sky. As he did and he pitched his tent or lay down in days gone by, here he put through by his roadside on the field of battle. Our comrade is in the hand of our heavenly Father, and God giveth him his speech. He will be laid to rest. Let us learn to cherish his virtues and imitate them. Be minded by the place he filled the horrors that our ranks won't know, that he won't be so loyal to every virtue, so true to every virtue, so faithful and remaining mercy, that he will be ready to fall out and take his place in the great review of heaven. Not in doubt, but with faith, that the merciful captain of our salvation will call him to that fraternity which on earth and heaven remains unbroken.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you prepare yourself for the rifle fire, we fire a rifle salute out of our departed comrade. Port arm. Left, right, face. Face. Aim. Fire.
Thank you. It's a sad day. But all of us, Tracy in particular, thank you all for being here. And I know Bill, thank you all for being here. And he loved everybody in this room. He made that perfectly clear, Bill. Kept a lot of notes. Stacks and stacks of notes. He reflected a lot. He spoke of the inevitable. And I can't tell you how many references there were to how much he loved the people in his world that loved him. And I know that we all miss him. Great. We're going to have a series of speakers come up and maybe tell just a brief overview of Bill's life. Some of you maybe know him a long time. I'm a 30-year man, proudly. We were in our 20s. And some of you maybe not as long. But if you met him and he touched your heart, that's why you're here today. And so again, I know that his message was loud and clear. Tell the people that love me that I love them more. And hopefully we can make this joyful in some aspect or another and celebrate an amazing man. Complicated, fun-loving, generous man. And I also know that he expects us to look after each other without him being around to physically help us out. I suspect he'll find other ways, and you'll know him when you see him. So, I thought I'd go ahead and ask some of the other folks that are wanting to speak on their times with Bill. Tracy, do you want to wait to the end, or do you want to speak on his childhood? Tracy's going to come up and speak a little about Bill's early days. Not too many of us knew him here from the South. He was raised up north for a long time, and we all appreciate Tracy coming up and sharing some of those moments, and then a high school friend will come up and join that, a career dear friend as well. So keep your hearts and minds open and loving and grateful, and just all believe that he's down here appreciating this as well. I know he is. Tracy, if you've got it in you, come on.
And first of all, I just want to thank everybody for coming, and thank everybody for loving Bill. And those that didn't know him but knew me, thank you for being here. When we grew up in Pennsylvania. I don't know if everybody knew that, but we grew up in a small little town. And Bill loved the childhood that we had. Growing up in Pennsylvania, going to the shore every summer, spending time with our cousins. And my cousins couldn't be here because they couldn't travel. So Mitch is videoing this, and we've actually shared some of it with them, so I appreciate everything that Mitch has done, and Ronnie and his wife, and Mitch's wife, Vicki. But there's a lot of things that nobody knew about Bill before we moved to Texas, because he was so young, and one of the main things is that, I don't know how many people knew, but he actually went by Jamie. He was not Bill. And it was so hard for us to, my mom and I could not not change that. And he was still Jamie to us, even at holidays. But if we ever said that name in front of his junior high and high school friends, we were like guilted for a long time. So those are some of the things that, if you knew him, you knew some of the things that he really loved and he really cherished, which is the beach. And he loved to draw, which led him to his profession later in life. And he loved his friends, and he loved sports. And he loved leftovers, and he loved my mother like no other. So just know that everything that he did with any of y'all, he cherished it. There were so many boxes in his apartment of letters and cards and thank yous. He was such a girl. I didn't think that I was ever gonna stop finding boxes in his closet and stuff. So thank you all for everything. His Texans crew, all y'all, he loved y'all. Like, that was his passion, was his Texans crew. And just a special, really a special note to Billy and where's Walter and Gibbs. You all, thank you for finding my mom's jersey. And Eddie and Gibbs, for finding my mom's jersey. My brother, we hang this in the rafters at the Texans games every Sunday, and he would take pictures of it every Sunday before the Texans game and send me text and say that he was here with mom, moms, and just wanted me to know. And so thank you all for finding this, and thank you for getting it to me clean. Thanks, Gibbs. And so that I could wear it today, in honor of my brother, and just one of his favorite things, and so now it will be one of mine. So thank you again.
I am strong as run, and I've known Bill since seventh grade. We had a French class together that was at that time. And so, and I remember, like Tracy says, I knew he was called Jamie. And that's how we used to get on his nerves, is telling him that he would sing that Van Halen song, Jamie's Crying. And fortunately, he couldn't run very fast, so he could get away from him. But I mean, this is bringing back floods and floods of memories. And I do have one question. How the hell did David Todd make that and I did that? Oh, I'm just kidding. Probably because the party was always at David Todd's house, and Bill would invite himself. You know, and it's funny, some of these things y'all talk about, like, you can hear Try My Drink. Yeah, we started that a long, long, long time ago before there was ever in a Houston Texans team. And, you know, I drive down 90 whenever I'm going to the medical center in that direction, and I mean, every single damn time I go down there, I'm reminded of me and Bill. We would drive over in my little crappy-ass Pinto station wagon. Yeah. At 7:30 in the morning on the way to school, we would buy a six-pack of beer, and we would have it in our Letterman jackets. And we could usually drink one or two, but in the 10 minutes it took to get to school, we would have the other one stuffed in our jacket, and we just thought we were the coolest thing in the world. I mean, we weren't, but we thought we were. And there's so many stories like that. We had so much fun, and you know, like Ronnie, I know, when we got a little bit older, Ronnie, y'all started hanging out way more because I moved. And my little brother, who after I moved, started hanging out with my brother Darren, and he said that, and he wanted to be here today, but he said it was real tough for him. He said, because, you know, whenever he would see Bill, somewhere, he said, no matter what, he would come up and hug me. He would make me feel like the most important person in the world. And, you know, and I was thinking about that, and I'm almost done, but I can think of lots of words to describe Bill. Some of them not as flattering. Sometimes it was a little annoying. And he could be a little loud at times, especially with a few drinks in him. But one thing that you can never, ever say about him is that he was never mean to anybody ever in his life. He really was probably the sweetest person in the world. Okay, sisters don't count. Sisters and stepbrothers. I take that back. Sisters and stepbrothers don't count. But other than that, there was nobody that I can't ever recall anything like that. But and there's a lot of other memories that from football, from going up to Austin, from going to see concerts, from playing, playing basketball for hours in his front yard. And he had that green truck that one day finally got it started. And he got to drive it for a while. But he was just a sweetheart of a guy. He really was. And I know that I hope he's got some peace now. If nothing else, I hope he's found some peace in Kerlax. And he really realized, from everybody here that he was very, very loved. And he will be missed for this.
My name's Gary Sims. I grew up with Bill and Tracy, and like Charles Road as well. We moved to Finder Southwest probably, summer of 78. And like Charles said, we would go over to Triple Crown. That's the name of the street. And play basketball. And Bill, he's not the, when it comes to basketball, but the most athletic person. But he'd be out there trying. Charles and I were playing as well. And Mr. Davies, of course, he's out there with a cigarette on his lip the whole time playing with his kids. It was a sight to see. Bill's a good friend of mine, known him a long time. After I graduated high school and went off to school and he served his country, we lost touch a little bit, but we did kind of keep in touch here and there. And probably over the last 8 to 10 years, whenever I came home, I live in Waco, Texas, now in McGregor, which is about 15 miles west of here. I'm gonna make a point to stop by and visit in a little bit. I know what you just did. But I would always make a point to stop by and visit every time I got a chance to come home. And this last time my wife and I came home, we had came home from my mother's surprise birthday party, and we were just kind of in and out, and we didn't stop and visit. And my wife posted something on Facebook, and Bill saw it, and he was like, "Hey, what happened?" I was like, "Hey, man, I'm sorry. It was a quick trip. That's why we didn't stop to see you. Because that Thanksgiving I hadn't stopped. When my wife and I were both stopped by, that was the last time I saw him. But we got to a point where we got so close that we called each other my brother from another mother. I mean, Bill, I'm going to say he is because he's still in here. He's the most loving, giving people ever known. I mean, I know Charles says he's sweet. That might be a different Bill than I know. But no, really, he's a sweet guy. He loves you. He loves hard. He knows no other way. He just loves hard. And I remember when my wife and girlfriend at the time, we first started dating and entered a relationship. I posted something on Facebook that said, "This is Preston tonight. This is my beautiful girlfriend. This is how it happened." And Bill being Bill is football terminology. He posted something back, "Hey Gary, you outkicked your coverage." So I come back and say, "Well, Bill, I have a mad game. You don't know I have great coverage." And of course, Tracy had something sweet. "Hey, I think it's a great catch." And so Thank you for that, Tracy. I'm going to miss Bill. I love him.
I'm going to take you guys back about 40 years. First day of class, ninth grade, I walk into class and I see one empty desk. So I sit down, notice there's a piece of paper and a pencil there, and I think, well, there's no one here. So I wad the paper up, toss it, put the pencil behind my ear, thinking you never have too many pencils. And I think I got my seat for the day or for the semester. All of a sudden I get a tap on the shoulder. And it's look up and it's this blonde-headed guy, outweighs me by about 50 pounds. Says, I'm sitting there. So, no, I think I'm sitting there. So one thing leads to another, and we end up tussling, rolling around the floor, getting after. Keep in mind, I've never met this guy before in my life. Never seen him before. First day of ninth grade. He ends up on top of me, go figure, about to bash my face in. And teacher walks in, breaks it up. To this day, I can't remember who actually ended up sitting in that seat. I honestly can't remember. Did I sit in that seat? Or did he sit in that seat? But at any rate, that afternoon was the first day of football practice. So I walk out on the field, and who do I see? That big blonde-haired guy that outweighed me by 50 pounds. So I decided, well, I should go, apologize because he is a little bit bigger than me. So I walk up, introduce myself, say I apologize for earlier. No hard feelings, and he's like, yeah. I said, by the way, you're lucky that the teacher broke it up, or I would have went through. And of course, that he belted that big baritone laugh at him. But ever since then, we've been fast friends, great friends, and there's not a better friend in the world I could imagine than Will Davies. He was just so down to earth. I know it's a cliche, and I hate to say it, but he would give you the last Texan shirt off his back. He really would. So that's my first recollection of Bill. But we've been fast friends ever since, and my life is just so much better, so much more enriched, having known him. I'm so glad that we met. And I have no doubt that he's up there right now looking down and going, you know what? I'm the one that sat. So God bless you, Bill. And I hope you, if I'm lucky enough to get there, I hope you
show me around when I get there. Thanks, Jeff. I'm going to attempt this. Bill and I were inseparable. Ever since high school and military, we've just been inseparable ever since. And I tried thinking of something to say as I just wrote down something that I heard. I'm going to read that. It fits to the T. Letting you go was not easy. Losing you was not fair. A brother is like no other, and we made quite a pair. One day you would torch me, the next defend me to another. You were my best friend in addition to my brother. Standing in the cemetery, my heart is aching so. Today I say goodbye without letting you go. I love you, Bill, and I'll miss you forever.
I was asked to speak on Bill's pride and purpose in life that God through his work and his career. So this is how that story goes. 25 years ago, on a Friday night, I went to a bar, a certain bar I went to every Friday night. There was a friend of mine there who was an instructor at the technical college. And he had drafting, that was his class. I handed him my business card and I said, send me your most talented student. Next week, Bill Davis walks into my office with my business card. We hired him. He was happy. We were happy. 25 years later, we saw each other every business day. Hardly took vacations, hardly took days off. Seldom said. He first started drafting all of our millwork drawings, did a good job. So then we got him to do some project managing and drafting. And then eventually we just got rid of the drafting. Jim Quesnell started doing our drafting and got him to do project managing. He did a good job of that. My business partner, Juan Garcia, got mad at the guy who owned the company that we were at, took off about the year 2001. 2002, I took off. Bill took over the project managing of the NRG Stadium, where we all used to go and love. Some of us may have some mixed feelings today, but at some point I hope we're back there and we're loving. Pretty soon, Bill came over with us, and we made him a project manager. And some of the projects that he was influential in completing were hundreds of hospitals, clinics, doctor's offices, hospitals like Bentop, Memorial Hermann, Methodist, MD Anderson, UTMB. Like I said, then he took over NRG and he landed that plane for us. Then when he came over to us, one of his notable projects was Sam Houston State University's Performing Arts Center. It was featured on Channel 13 as one of the best performing arts theaters for us, for a college in America. One of his, dear to his heart, was he completed five of the Texas A&M Corps Cadets dorms. Whoop. And even more importantly, he recently, I think it was within a year or so, completed the Texas A&M New School of Music, the home of the Fighting Aggies Marching Band. Another whoop. And he was very proud of that one. And his last project was the Lakeside Country Club that he completed with Jim and Juan. And he did all the estimating and began the project managing of that. And at the end of that, that project became one of the best country clubs in America. Far better than the River Oaks Country Club, the Houston Country Club, and my own country club, Sweetwater Country Club, and I'm not jealous. But it looks really good. It was very expensive, and Jim will testify, it was very difficult.
Bill worked on that job for 3 years.
And there was a problem every day. But that job was finally over in February. And then March 10th. Communist Chinese gave us a worldwide pandemic, and on Friday, March 13th, the president declared a national emergency. Most everyone never went back to work, at least didn't go into their office, worked from home, even if they had a job. We were declared an essential industry. We continued as normal. We went to the office every day. We did everything normally. All of our job sites stayed open. We completed our job sites. We were working on emergency rooms and hospitals. It became even more necessary that they could complete. That Monday, Bill decided that he would prefer to work from home, and he was wise to do so in one way. Bill smoked a lot. Everyone knows that. He knew he had compromised lungs, and if he'd gotten an infection in those lungs, it could have been fatal, which is ironic. So we set him up working from home, and he did a damn good job for 3 months. We would send him over bids, he'd get them done. He interfaced with the customers and the contractors, and everything went smoothly until about the third month. Then I saw he was slipping. He was kind of losing contact with us. And he just wasn't responding right then. I asked him to come back. I said, Bill, you need our structure. You need to come into the office every morning. You need us around you. Because we offer you stability in your life, and he knew it. But he said, I'm still afraid. I'm gonna get it. We do have a lot of people in construction industries that have had it. About 2 weeks ago, he called and he said he was having some physical problems. Juan offered to take him to the hospital, to the doctor, to the clinic. He said he'd get his sister to do it, he'd get his friends to do it. He called up the next day, said the doctor said it's a nervous condition and gave him tranquilizers. We thought it was fine. Then he called last week, said, or about 10 days ago, said he was having some problems. Once again, we offered to take him. He said, no, I just don't want to go. The next call we got was from Tracy, and it was all over. I suspect that his world turning upside down, losing the structure and the discipline of coming to work and being around us, we would have seen something was wrong. We would have taken care of it. But we weren't there to do that. The joy that he had from sports was gone. A lot of joy in life was gone. I suppose he just lost his writing. Well, he went off the track. He left a big hole in our little company. He left a big hole in our hearts. As long as his memory is in our hearts and minds, we will remember him until the day we died. And that's the end of the worst.
I really appreciate everybody for sharing this, and we have some more to go. We have high notes, we have low notes. Maybe it's time for a little high notes. I know his brotherhood of Texans blue crew are here. I'd like them to come up either one at a time or together and share what was, other than just loving his friends, his greatest passion in the world. So Billy or whoever wants to join us first from the Houston, Texas Blue Crew, to which Bill was a proud member.
Stand up, Billy. still right. He didn't say it. Good luck. Anyway, yeah, I've known Bill now for, I guess it's been 16 years. Like, he's been taking things off about 18 years. And I wasn't in it until the crew until about the third year. Yeah, first, I was friends with him the first time you see him, yet he's your friend already. You know, and, always smiling. He's a good one, no doubt. That is him, so it's going to be real quiet with that. We lost Joe Jackson last year, which we laughed together, we cried together. Very hard. We got, they said we can only 60 seconds, but I know Catherine can't speak for 60 seconds. I'm not sure I can either, but I'll just tell you, without them being there, people came in from all over the country to see. Come to our tailgate. We entertained everybody in the NFL. So, and a lot of times people have been there more than once. Where's Bill? Or should I say Texan Jamie? No, I just don't have a ring to it. Might have known that if you pissed him off. I'd have been telling him all the time. But I know he loved his family. He missed his mother. Loved his flag. Loved his military.
Cowboys
still suck. Yes, sir. So I'm going to keep it short because it's hot. I know everybody wants to go home, but rest in peace, brother. We'll miss you.
Hi, my name is Catherine Currier. My husband and I, we've been with the Blue Crew from day one. Billy's was part of that. Our kids came out there and he loved our kids, especially my daughter. He would always ask about Kimball. Whatever we needed at the tailgate, Billy would provide. He would help set up, he would help us tear down. I'm gonna miss him. It kind of kill for leaving us because tailgate's not going to be the same without him. He was one hell of a guy, and they broke the mold with him. He'd always say, "Hey, Catherine, have a sip of my drink." I'll take a sip. No, that's straight. Catherine, there's some cranberry in there. Are you talking a smidge? So, and he would always help us out with the shots. He would always cheer us on. Whatever we needed, he would give us. He would give us the shirt off his back. And when your mom passed away, he said, "Catherine, I'll have mom's jersey." Okay. So we'd always hang it up. He was so proud of that. We would have to stop constructing the tents so we could put the jersey up there. If it was already up, we would have to take it down so he could put mom's jersey up there. It's just, I can't believe that person is gone now. I mean, Billy is gone. Bill, I'm going to truly miss him. That's about all I can say. No. But he loved him. He loved his family. He loved the Texans. He loved us. So that's all I'm going to say.
Hello, everyone. My name is Sandy. I don't know if I get through this. Better known to the Blue Crew and to Bill as Grandma. He was one of the dearest friends that I had on that parking lot. I don't know if I can cram 18 years of friendship into 60 seconds, but I'm going to try. It's going to be very difficult. Our tailgate started in 2002. There were a small group of us, about 10 or 12, we met on the corner of the parking lot. Most of us were strangers. We grew to be friends. And then over the course of the past 18 years, we became family. Bill was such a huge part of that because every tailgate, every day, every game that we were there, that we had, he was one of the first ones there. He was there to greet everybody with a hug, a kiss, a hello. Even Cowboy and Titan fans, which he hated with passion. And I could tell you so many colorful words that came out of Bill's mouth when it came to talking about those two teams. But in the long run, he loved them all. And he let everyone know that he loved them. He loved his family. He loved his tailgating family. Above all, he loved his moms and his sister. We spent many, many times, many, many hours talking about family, talking about football, talking about life in general, and just being friends. And I think in the end, that's what we all are. None of us know where the NFL is going to end up. Personally, I don't care. And I think Bill pretty much had the same feeling. We shared that feeling in a conversation we had in July. I don't know if we'll ever tailgate again. I hope we do. But I do know one thing, that regardless of where all of our blue crew members go, we'll always take Bill's spirit with us. Because you can't go. You can't have a tailgate. You can't have a football game that you don't have that feeling of that spirit of Bill Davies being there with you. I was reading on the back of the little brochure that y'all gave us, and there's the third a part is very appropriate. If my parting has left a void, which it definitely has, then fill it with remembered joy. And that's what we all need to do at the time, because we have so many fond memories. Such a fine and wonderful man. A friendship shared, a laugh, a kiss. Oh yes, these things I too shall miss. That was our Bill. And I know he's up there looking down on us with Joe and Marcy and Enzo King and all of our little group of tailgaters that have all gone on before me. I'm the oldest of the group and I really had no idea that I'd ever outlive some of them. But up there looking down on us, and I love Bill. He said he was one of my own kids, and he loved me, and that's what I'm taking with me for him.
Ambulance. I saw him leave. I made sure he had something to eat. I brought him his water, his drink, although he freaking didn't need it at all. And I made sure that I controlled at least his consumption, because anybody who knew him would know that he'd be stubborn. I didn't go get it shipped. We have it ordered. Delivered. But that was my brother. And no matter what, I know he's smiling down on all of us. Because he did love, and he did love hard. He was a great person. I'm really, really going to miss him. We all are. Thank you.
Tracy, everybody here appreciates everybody that shared. Bill appreciated hearing everybody's kind words, and he would just tell you, you know, twice as much right back at you. Tracy, in a minute, I think if you're up for it, you're gonna close things. I guess a couple of things to say about my friend, brother. He taught me a lot. I worked with Bill and Tobin in that crazy business for a few years, in a time in my life when I needed it. I had a young family. Bill reached out to me, and he gave me a great place of employment, and he taught me every day how to do it. Heartlessly, every day. It might be over a couple of cocktails at the sports bar after work, but it was every day. And that skill base allowed me to move on in life. It really formed the person who I am today, and I'll always have that to thank Bill for. So there's just so much, and you don't know how to find the time to say it all. I'll add this, that I think maybe like all of us, Bill was a man of multitudes. I think as much love as there was in him, there was pain. Pain that he refused to share. He burdened himself, and himself only. And everything else he just put into love. To the world, to people in his world. And for whatever stubborn ass reason, he hung on to that darkness that, again, I think we all have some version of that in us. Sometimes he did his best to keep it from the rest of us. He just didn't want us to feel any of that he felt. So Bill had, you know, he had skeletons in his closet, and I'll share a secret on that note, that having recently cleaned, helped Tracy putting up Bill's stuff, that something else he also had in his closet was 19 rolls of tinfoil. I don't know what that is about. Now I have 19 rolls of tinfoil. I don't know if he was making hats out of them. I don't think anybody could cook that much brisket. So when I think of things that Bill kept to himself, I want to think about tinfoil. I choose to think about that.
Why would you never find any?
Never. But I also think, I know, there was a side of him that and wanted to share more. Just couldn't bring himself to do it. But he, as I said, left some journals, left some notes. And one of them is on the back of that card, that the square one with his picture on it. Got a little version of it here. And I'm going to do my best for you. This is what I think. Let me say this first. Regardless of this, bigger than this, and what we need to leave with is the love. But those of us that knew him and maybe wondered, you know, why he indulged as much as he did at times, he left us an answer. And it's a song that you're going to hear 10 times a day now that I put it out there. I know I have, it's ridiculous. Literally the second song I heard when I was pulling out of this house. And it's a good song, Bill liked this music. There's another world inside of me that you may never see. There's secrets in this life that I can't hide. Somewhere in this darkness, there's a light that I can't find. Maybe it's too far away, or maybe I'm just blind. So hold me when I'm here, right me when I'm wrong, hold me when I'm scared. Love me when I'm gone. Everything I am and everything in me wants to be the one you wanted me to be. I'd never let you down, even if I should. I'd give up everything, if only for your good. So hold me when I'm here. Write me when I'm wrong. Hold me when I'm scared. And love me when I'm gone. When your education x-ray cannot see under my skin, I won't tell you a damn thing that I could not tell my friends. Roaming through this darkness, I'm alive, but I'm alone. Part of me is fighting this, but part of me is gone. So hold me when I'm here, right me when I'm wrong. Hold me when I'm scared, and hold me when I'm gone. All right, charming note, Tracy, would you like to come up and close this out for us?
Relationship. We had peaks and valleys, ebbs and flows, but one thing for sure is that he knew that I loved him truly and that I knew he loved me truly. And that boy used to protect me and be so territorial when it came to me. But these last few months since COVID, when everybody was on lockdown, we would talk and I would know that there was something wrong, and I would, like, you know, be that tough love sister and say, what's wrong? And he would never really fully give me the information. He would never fully tell me what was really wrong. But the one thing that I know that he used to say, that he missed my mom so much in 7 years, and he never got over the loss of her. This ate him up every single day from the day that she passed. So I just want everybody to know that everybody out there truly needs someone in their life at all times. It doesn't matter how good a friend you are, there's still gonna be something that they're missing that they don't have any here to give back. And that's what Bill was missing. He was missing my mom. And no matter what I did, I was never gonna be my mom for him. I tried, but I wasn't gonna be her. Every day, he used to tell me that we talked, that he could not wait to be with my mom. That says a lot. So for anybody that is going through any types of mental health issues, or abandonment, or separation, or whatever it is right now going through, especially in this time in the world, just please know that he lost part of his life already in his heart when my mom passed. But he didn't stop him from loving every single person that he came in contact with. So I have to truly believe that he loved the way my mom would love, and he continued that love. So all I want is everybody to just love each other and be there for each other, and please don't ever forget my brother. And everything that he meant to you, just keep it in your heart. Thank y'all for coming.
Again, thank everybody for coming. We're going to close the ceremony now, and just please take care of each other. That's what you'll want. Thank you again.
To Bill.
Bill.
Next to Jamie.